This is the last part in our series on food choices and human health. And in this section, we'll be covering reliable resources. We're going to move on to talking about some reliable resources. And this week, you are required to find websites that are what you consider reliable or unreliable. The reason I'm having you do this is because there are so many websites out there with very incorrect or biased or flat-out wrong information on nutrition. And some websites have some good information, some have some bad information, and some are a combination, and some are wonderful resources. It's difficult to know what resources you can use, especially when you're coming without a good background in nutrition. In the lessons folder at the very bottom, I do have a section called Health and Nutrition Resources. I have a list of resources for you there, which I consider reliable. So you can always go to that folder and find those resources at any time throughout the semester. But for this week, I want you to go out and find a reliable resource and find an unreliable and tell me why you think they're reliable and unreliable. Now, when we think about a reliable resource, you know, any of the academic journals, these are generally peer-reviewed journals. This is important because it means that people in their field of research are reviewing their work, not somebody who's not in that field. So as soon as you have a peer review process, you're going to increase the reliability of that resource. Most university websites are very good resources as well. Again, because there is just a natural peer review process built in. There are a lot of informational websites, and some are good, some are bad. What you need to do to when you get to one of these websites, is look for the author. If you just have a website, there's no author, then there's less chance of it being a reliable resource. There should always be an about area where you can click on the tab and look for credentials. Look for their degrees or their affiliations. If they're affiliated with the university, they have a PhD, they've done some research, then there's a greater chance that you're going to get good nutrition information or health information from this website. And if the author has been published by a university press, that's even a better sign, or in a peer-reviewed journal. And especially if they have any academic affiliations, because you know a lot of people fancy themselves nutrition experts, but they really have no degree and no training. They haven't published any works, any research projects, studies, anything. Now, I'm not saying that just because they don't have that, they may not give good information. But if you're coming without a nutrition background, you need to know you're going to a reliable resource. So major news sources. These, if you look at NPR, ABC, NBC, CNN, some of these major news networks sometimes give good information. I think what you really need to do when you go to a news network is you want to see the study that they are talking about. And generally when they have a news report, they are talking about a study. It should be cited. And we talked about citations, and I'll go over that in a minute. That's what I say. The study they're talking about should be cited. It is a source of frustration for me when I'm looking for information on the internet and I come to a article from a news source and they mention that there's a study that's been done, but they don't have the citation at the bottom. It takes me a long time to track down that study so I can see if they are reporting it correctly. You want to make sure that they, you know, have their basic facts down. So although you can somewhat trust some of the major news networks, sometimes they are trying to get people to the site. They are more sensational. They're reporting some key features of the article, but they're not reporting others. Remember, networks want to sell you things. Well, they want to sell advertisers. sell sell space to advertisers, which means they need you as readers. So sometimes the topics are going to seem more sensational than they really are. Another good way to look at a news resource is look for if the lead investigator of the article or the research is interviewed, and there's basically an interview there from the lead investigator, then generally you know that reporter has done some good research and you can find that resource a little bit more reliable. And then also look at the URL. .gov, .edu, and .org are going to be a little bit more reliable than others, but this doesn't mean that someone with a .com or .net is unreliable. It just is just another step. It's something else to look for. So what is a biased website? What are you looking for? Well, if the website is sponsored by a lobbyist group, and this sometimes can be difficult, but if you look at the About Us page and see who they're supporting, and I'll go over this more in a minute, because they're not going to say, we are a lobbyist group. They're going to be supporting a major corporation or organization. Immediately, they're going to be biased towards that information. A site with an agenda. So, obviously, the tobacco industry is probably going to have an agenda for selling more cigarettes. And I know I put this down because there are a lot of links between the tobacco industry and the food industry now, even though the tobacco industry was more of a problem a couple decades ago. Is the site trying to sell you something? These days, almost all websites, good or bad, are going to have some advertisements. So you will always see advertisements, but how prominent are the ads popping up on, you know, every time you scroll over something, is an ad popping up? Is it at the bottom, at the top? If there's more sales than content, that's a problem. And besides being extremely frustrating, it's something that you should also take as this little bell should go off in your head that maybe it's not very good content. The author is not listed. Sometimes you can still find good information if the author's not listed, but if you go to a website and there's no author listed and there's no citations from where they're getting their research, there are a lot of ads. You don't see any affiliation with a university, or you don't see any information about who the website is supporting or not, then this is a cue that maybe it's not a good website, and maybe it's not a reliable resource. Anytime a study is being mentioned, or anytime someone says it has been proven that, there should be a resource there. What is the research that shows the proof? You should always ask yourself that question. And when you post in the discussion forum and you say, well, everybody knows that, or it's proven that, you better make sure you know that everybody knows that. How does everyone know that? And what is the research and the reason why everyone knows that? You need to always support yourself with research and citations to show that it has been proven, because what you know might not be what's really true. And I always want you to ask yourself that. How do I know what I know? And where do I go to find that information? So that's where we look at the, maybe you've been reading biased websites, or maybe your friend's been reading biased websites and has been telling you information. Or maybe the media has been sensationalizing and everything has just been coming in and filtering through your brain, and now you feel as if it's a known fact when it may not be. Each time you always want to ask yourself that, and then go back and try to find if you disagree with the textbook, myself, which is fine. I don't mind that at all. But if that is the case, I want you to show me the website or the research to support your stance. And that allows you to think a little bit more critically about what we're learning and what you think you already know. So a couple examples. This is the Corn Refiners Association website. Now, this could be a fantastic page to get information, a fantastic website to get information about how corn is refined and what it's used for. This is the Corn Refiners Association. You are very likely to find out a lot of information about that. What you are not going to likely get reliable information is the health impact of refined corn products, because that's not their job. Health is not the Corn Refiners Association's job. Their job is to refine corn and sell it to you. So it could be a reliable resource in some instances, but an unreliable resource in other instances. The Sugar Association, again, you know, they, you know, here they have a something here, sugar versus high fructose corn syrup, and you might find some reliable information about these subtle differences about how sugar is refined and processed. But it's a fact, sugar is part of a healthy diet. Okay, this right here, already problematic. We're going to learn that really it's not part of a healthy diet, or less has to be less than 5% of your diet in order to be considered healthy. But already right off the bat, it's misleading. And the Sugar Association is not someone who should be giving advice on health. So again, this could be a reliable resource in some instances, but not other instances. You can always go up and click, you know, the About Us area web page and read through it to see really what their agenda is, what their goal is. Now here is an example of a peer-reviewed academic journal, the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition. This is a great place to find out information and research. You will most likely only be able to access the abstracts, although some of their articles you can read all of the information. But even the abstract, since this isn't a class on how to critically analyze research, you can still go to the abstract and read through their results and conclusion and find out the information. So this is would be a good resource. Now here is an example of a website that as soon as you enter it, as you roll over, refine, what you're going to do is you're going to get something that pops up, and it's going to be an ad. So you have different, every time things that pop up, they're going to be ads. You have an ad down on the bottom. You have an ad down on the side. There is, you're not seeing the whole web page here, but you're not given any information about the author. They are high sugar diet has a number of adverse health effects. Okay, that's, you know, we will learn about that, but where's the research supporting that? Where are the citations? So when you see these statements, you always want to see citations somewhere. They should be at the bottom. They should have resources to show you where they got the information. So this site right here is something that when you get to, you should say, okay, this is maybe not my best resource. Maybe this isn't a reliable resource. PubMed, this is a search engine, essentially. It's a place where you can find, where you can research, search for articles from journals. And it's a huge database. So you would go in and type in, and let's say we're just looking for information on sugar, and search, and usually you want to be a little more refined than that, and it's going to give you a number of articles, and you can click there. You'll always get the abstract. Sometimes some are open source, so you can get the full article at other times. And again, I have a link to this in your health and nutrition resources. Lastly, I want to go through the citations, and this is AMA format, American Medical Association. When you cite an outside resource, whether it's an article or a web page, and I'm going to ask you to do this throughout the semester, you need to cite in AMA format. This is standard for any college class. Some professors are going to use the APA format, but this is, we're more of a science-based class, so I want you to use the medical format, learn how to do this. You can always refer back to this information in the notes, and I usually give you a link to this web page so you can see the format. The basic idea is that you start with the author, and then you put the title. So this is Effects of Managed Care. Then you list the journal name. Usually that's going to be in italics. And then you have the date, And generally it says the volume and then the page number. So why do we do this? Why is this a standard? It's because if you're citing information, trying to prove your point, then you want to cite your source so others can check it. And this is one of my pet peeves on the internet, is when I go searching for information and I find what I think is a good informational website, and there's, you know, information, and they're talking about an article or a study, and they don't cite their source. It drives me insane, because I want to find that source. I want to go to that source. I want to read that article. And if they don't cite it, it makes it so difficult. So with you, what if you're citing your source throughout the semester, make sure that you give that information in as much detail as possible. In addition to this, if you can put in a hyperlink, and for example, you can see the HTTP, and it gives the link as well. So if you go to a web page. So for example, an electronic journal article, you have the names, the authors, the title of the journal. Again, you have the date, volume, page number, the DOI number. You can also put that in. I like students to put in a hyperlink so others can just have a one-click access to the citation, to the article. If you're just doing a web page, so if you're doing a web page, so internet document, let's say you went to the American Cancer Society and you looked at their facts. So you would put the title, and generally this is not going to have an author because they probably had many authors to come up with this information. So you have the title of the web page, then the title of the organization, American Cancer Society, this title of the page, Cancer Facts and Figures 2003, and then the link to the site. And importantly, you have to put when it's accessed. I'm going to go up to here. Access August 22nd, 2007. Now, why is this important? This is important because information changes. If you have a book, it's a static document. If you have a website, it's dynamic. It's constantly changing. They may have updated it. You accessed it on 2007, 2008. They changed the information based on new research. Very important that you put it when it was accessed. Okay, and that is it for this chapter, and we'll start again next week.